like to call the meeting to order. Please join me in the pledge of allegiance, please.
Pledge of allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Before we get started this morning, I'd like to ask you, last week, the Ramsey County family lost a big member of our community, longtime resident, farmer Richard Volk, passed away tragically last Wednesday. And Richard was more than just a community member. He was a 4-H leader. He was a past super school board member. He was a township officer and a member of the Ramsey County Fair Board for the past 29 years, where Commissioner Olson and myself got to work with him quite regularly. So if you could join me in a moment of silence in memory of Richard, please. Thank you. And we ask that you keep Mr. Volk's family in your thoughts and prayers as they go through this very difficult time. Approval of minutes.
Move to approve.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Bills. We have a list of bills in your packets as well as some additional bills that have come in.
And the law enforcement center bill that is on the website.
Law enforcement center as well. We want to approve everything at once.
Motion to approve.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Wakefield?
Aye.
Olson?
Aye.
Brown?
Aye.
Britt?
Aye. Financials. Any updates, changes on that, Candy?
No, we're doing good. No major surprises yet.
Motion to approve the financials.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? Roll call on that.
Brown?
Aye.
Wakefield?
Aye.
Olson?
Aye.
Britt?
Aye. Approval of treasurer's checks. List of treasurer's checks in your packets as well.
Move to approve.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Roll call, please.
Olson?
Aye.
Wakefield?
Aye.
Brown?
Aye.
Britt?
Aye. Approval of the agenda. Any additions to the agenda this morning?
Move to approve. Second.
Moved and seconded for the agenda. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Agenda stands as approved. Sarah, extension agent, please.
Yeah, just a little update. I want to thank you, Jeff, for bringing up the sudden and tragic passing of Richard Volk. He was a longtime supporter and advocate of 4-H, and we're just going to miss him immensely in our office. So, so shooting sports. We are just finishing up our air rifle season, and we do have some kids participating in some district competitions this weekend, and then we are actually hosting the state competition here in Devil's Lake in April, so we're pretty excited about that. Our four girls who are competing in the national competition, they've been busy fundraising, and they're going to start hitting it hard here with their practices. We've got our Field of Fork event coming up for the fourth graders on April 2nd. That'll be held in the Memorial Building and Armory. So that'll be a full day of, you know, over 350 kids coming in and out throughout the day. So we're pretty excited about that. And Bill's been pretty active with the private and commercial applicator licenses. He's got a couple of classes in Devil's Lake and one in Hampton. And all of those licenses need to be renewed every 3 years. So staying on top of that. And I've been hitting it hard with a nutrition education in the area schools and trying to really promote hand washing with those kids. So if you guys have any questions for extension.
Sir, what was the date on that field before it began?
April 2nd. So anybody's welcome to come and check it out.
And did you give us a date on the statewide competition?
I don't know that offhand. My son is actually competing in that. But I think it's the first weekend in April, the first Saturday.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Anything else for... Thank you. Crystal, HR report.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm not sure if you guys got the policies and had a chance to look at them yet. If you have questions on them or thoughts, they've been around for the department head meeting and got their input. For the progressive discipline policy, that's a new policy. And what I did with that, I give them two options with two different types of policies for progressive discipline. One was a real vague policy. And they voted, or not voted, but they wanted to go with more of an example. So if they have an issue come up, they can just pull the policy and see where it falls into, what type of discipline they need to move forward with. And then also in that discipline policy, towards the end, is a grievance in there and how an employee would grieve the discipline and come back if they have issues with it. So when I first resorted to the portfolio commissioner to be contacted first by the employee. And then if they're not satisfied with that, then that's when it comes over to the board with the grievance.
How did you say that went down at the end?
So if an employee wants to grieve the discipline, it gives them options on how, like a chain of command on how we would go about doing it. So the employee would first go to the portfolio commissioner, which should be already updated on what's happening with that discipline, because that department head or supervisor should be in contact with that portfolio holder. So, and if the portfolio holder agrees with it and isn't gonna, you know, change anything with it, then the employee, if they still don't feel satisfied, they can grieve it over to the board, and that's when the board would get involved in making that final decision on the grievance or on the disciplinary.
But we didn't have any policy like that.
We didn't, no. And we ran into quite a few situations where we're like, we really need a discipline policy.
Department heads, they didn't really want to handle that? Or?
What's that?
Department heads didn't really want to handle that end of it? Of disciplining the employee?
So it kind of fell into where, what do we do with this issue that we have? Where should it fall? Should we do a written warning? Should it be termination? Should it be a verbal warning? So there was just a lot of confusion on how, on the type of issue that we had, where it should fall. So this gives more of the supervisor, department head, more of a guidance on what they should do with that issue.
Okay, can you give me a feeling on what the department heads wanted to do? They wanted to do this.
Yeah, so we had, I gave them two options. One was a real vague, like, you know, like our first step would be a verbal warning, our next one would be a written warning, and it didn't have any examples in there of the type of issues that would fall into them. And so that's when they said that they would want to go with more set examples to the type of issues they could come into.
You're talking about the employee as far as what are they doing wrong?
Right.
Showing up late or?
Right.
What other instances would it be?
So some of the other instances we've had, being late was one, off the top of my head, what else have we fallen into? I know and we've had some conflicts. We've had an insubordinate, one insubordination, and we've had some conflict issues. Different ones like that.
Our policies, are they tough enough? Or, you know, are we writing these tough enough? I mean, I'm asking though, I'm not a human resource person at all.
Well, you know, you don't want to put it too tough where you're set to have to go a certain direction. You want to give yourself some options as an employer. So you don't want to just say, if you do this action, you're automatically terminated.
Well, does this also give the employee cause to, if these aren't followed through with specifically, to come back and file a grievance if they were terminated or reprimanded or disciplined in some way, shape, or form that, well, hey, you didn't follow this policy. You know, it says here that here's all the examples. This is what you should have done. This is what was done.
Yeah, so there is a part in there that, it states in there that this isn't inclusive and that, there's a part in there where it says that, you know, like, it, steps can be, depending on the situation, steps can be more progressive, and that it's not all inclusive. Let's see. The list of rules can include all instances of conduct that can result in discipline, and the list examples below is not exhaustive.
Okay.
Go into that next paragraph.
Just out of curiosity, I mean, I actually really like the way that you've broken this out into sort of different trees of punishment based on the severity. Under your group two, the first example is failing to report injuries or damage or an accident involving company equipment.
Mm-hmm.
Is that really something that we'd give you three strikes on? You know,
see, and that would go again, that's the severity of it. What, you know, what is the outcome of it? Is it severe? Is it we're wrecking a truck and we're not telling the supervisor? Or, you know what I mean? It depends on what the situation is.
Right. Yeah, okay.
And if there is any examples in there that you think that need to be moved around to different groups or anything, like I told them, mentioned to the department heads that you know, we can do that, and anything that needs to be switched around in there that they think should be more progressive. Where I got these examples from was, to start off with, the Society of Human Resources has policy development, and that's where I pulled it from, and then I went through and weeded out the ones that wouldn't pertain to county or that we would never run into. So I don't know if you guys want to review these more, or if you want to approve it today, or if you want to wait until the next meeting until you have a chance more to review it. If you have any other questions.
Well, I'd like to table it to review it some more, and I think it would be good to have Adam here also on this.
I'll second that.
Moved and seconded that we table the just the progressive discipline policy?
Yeah. And then we can keep talking.
Okay.
I guess one of the comments I have, Crystal, is you probably got the drift of it. I don't really like these department heads pass it on to the commission. I mean, it's their job to discipline employees.
Right.
I feel they should do that.
Well, I don't know.
I think it's just appealed up to you know, which already could have been.
Well, it seems like they can unhook from the card pretty quick to me and throw it at the commission.
So mainly you kind of want a little bit of a chain in there because you want
I agree with you there, but.
Yeah, you want that employee to have options within the organization before they go outside of the organization and say they go and file suit against us and we don't even, you know, didn't even realize maybe some things in there that we should have realized that they would have brought up to the board or to that next portfolio or So it's kind of more of a cover in having the steps in there to make sure that everything was covered before they go outside that, the organization kind of thing. But it shouldn't, the last resort is the board. That portfolio
True.
Commissioner
Agreed,
should be
yeah.
able to get that situation handled in there.
But the first resort is the department heads.
Right.
And they should have a policy that stipulates how their department should be run. And they have that, right? Should that be toughened up?
Well, for the most part, your bigger departments, I want to say like your sheriff's department, they have a separate policy manual.
Mm-hmm.
Your social services, they have a little bit more extra with the state.
Right.
That would be the main departments that I could think of that have a little bit more.
Road department?
Huh?
The road department.
I don't know if I've
What's he got?
I don't know if I've seen that Kevin has anything extra implemented.
Mm-hmm. I think that's something we should look into with that department. A janitorial department, ground department. We should look into that department also and see if they have a tough enough policy in their hand to carry out their position.
So are you thinking more along the lines of department heads, what their responsibilities
Absolutely.
Are kind of thing?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I'm kind of thinking, could that be more in the job description area? Of
yeah, probably, but I think they should have a manual that they can pass on to their employees and what they're expected of. You know, if they're expected to be there at 8, then they better be there, you know. Or have a really good excuse.
Yeah, and I would
and not continually use the excuse.
Right. And we had an instance where we've had to write up an employee for being late,
mm-hmm.
you know, consistently.
Did we use a did we have a policy in place for that then?
We didn't have a policy in place.
Mm-hmm.
But this would provide for that.
But I mean we do. As a commission, this is what we're gonna use. What's the department head's gonna use?
They're also going to use this.
Well, that's what this is for the department.
No, I think the department should have their own.
And I would think in your job descriptions, more being more specific to their line of duty of like exactly what they're supposed to be responsible for
mm-hmm.
is a good idea. Because our job descriptions, now that we have in place, they're, I don't want to say they're vague, but it could be more specific.
Right, I agree with you.
But I think it's important that, you know, we as a commission sort of enact a uniform disciplinary process for every department, because otherwise if you leave it to the departments to create their own disciplinary processes, you could end up with...
You're not going to be creating your own. You're going to use the HR person to help unify all the policies and getting the same, so all department heads are using somewhat of a policy for things like this.
But wouldn't that be this policy?
Pardon me?
Would that be this policy?
I don't think this is tough enough. I don't give enough direction to the department heads.
Do you think that we need to add more in there to the policy?
To the department heads, end of it, yes.
Okay.
I think this is fine for what we need. It tells us what to do when it gets up to us, but I don't want to see any of these things come to the commission. I just didn't see the department heads now. It's their department. They should take care of it. We're here to set policies. You know, pay the bills. We're not here to discipline all the time.
Mm-hmm.
Department head should take care of that.
Right, and I agree with you that they should take care of it, along with that portfolio
mm-hmm.
that's responsible for that position. But, you know, we're sometimes going to run into that issue though, where that board has to make the final decision. And
oh yes, you probably come, yeah.
That is fairly common if there is an issue that can't be agreed upon on how it should be handled. And I know we don't want things like that to come to the board because we want to try to stay clear of that. That's the best way to go.
Let's see if the department heads want to do it, see if they think it's strong enough.
Okay. I can run it past them again. And if there's something you think that needs to be added to it to be more inclusive to the department heads, yeah, that'd be good. other policy is the drug and alcohol free workplace policy. So on this one, so kind of where it started was that we're doing random drug testing on pretty much all of our employees, and it's come to light that we shouldn't be doing randoms on all employees, that they should only be in them safety sensitive positions, and that's due to that for public employers, it's due to the Fourth Amendment with unreasonable search is where it's coming down to. And I ran this through the association attorney and then also Carrie to have this change. So all we would do for our employees is, of course, everybody would have the pre-employment drug screen, and then only random tests would only be done on our safety sensitive positions, or else like our ones that are federally regulated, like our CDL drivers. So it's not, we wouldn't test anymore like people that are driving our county vehicles. It's going to fall more on the supervisor or department head to watch and have that reasonable suspicion training done, so they know exactly what to be watching for on that employee. So, and then of course, if there's reasonable suspicion, we can always drug test them. And then also, if we have, if they're in a vehicle accident or have a work injury, we would drug test if symptoms.
My only question on this, Crystal, is, I don't see it if it is in here. Is there anywhere in here that we define specifically what a safety sensitive job within the county would represent?
It's not here in the policy, but now we would have it in their job description listed in there if it falls under safety sensitive. So it's going to be our highway department and then, of course, our sheriff's department.
Sure. But that's not something that we need to sort of duplicate in this, in your opinion?
Right.
Okay. Well, I'd move to approve this.
We have a second on the approval of the changes to the drug and alcohol policy. Drug and alcohol free workplace. The official name.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
And I'll just bring back the regrets of discipline in the next meeting. Does that work?
Yep.
Okay. Like I said, if anybody has thoughts or comments on it, just to let me know.
Thank you, Crystal. Anything else, Crystal?
Nope, that was it.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Stacy and Bryce. Bryce, welcome.
If those of you don't know, this is Bryce Crosby. He's filling my shoes. And actually, he's well ahead of any learning curve already. Just in the last week, what we've done, Friday was one hell of a busy day. We had 19 people in on Friday. So we continue to stay busy anyway. And in my report, I included another annual report for last year. And for the year of 2019, we had 1,183 veterans at all sites. Compared to the year before, we had 1,198 veterans in 2018. So we're within 15 veterans of last year. So that's still saying we're seeing a lot of people come through that office. And it breaks down by county. Benson had a total of 61, and Nelson had a total of 94, which kind of surprised me even. I thought Benson might have had more than Nelson, but it's been a little bit busier over Nelson County. So, one of the things I'd like to say about Bryce and him catching on to everything, last week, the first 3.5 days of last week, our database program had crashed nationwide. So we were struggling to keep things, find things to do well. Bryce is reorganizing the office a bunch. Take a look. It's not the same house anymore. So just, and he says he's got more stuff to bring in. So, and we also started cleaning out the old files. And we're going to keep the shredding company in business for a while. Because we found documents, birth dates of
1897?
That were still in the files. I mean, they shouldn't have been, but that's from 1897 to in the 19-teens and 20s, quite a few files that we didn't need to have around anymore.
Those are almost historical documents at this point.
Yeah, I was going to say, are there any files in the family?
What we're required to do is go through, and the Bismarck would want us to keep commendations, commemorative awards, and items such as that for a period of 3 years. Well, that 3 years is long gone. And so far what we've looked at, there hasn't been anything to send to the Heritage Center.
Okay. How about the families? Is there any value to any of us?
Well, if we were going to start looking at locating families.
Well, I mean, within reason, I mean.
Yeah, and that's, I think we're more interested in updating and keeping the files up to date.
Right, right. But there's no awards or anything.
There can be, but in those situations, any of these things can be found in the archives, National Archives in St. Louis. So if the family needed something, and a lot of times we'll have grandchildren requesting a document, usually a discharge paper, for someone that was in a World War. And they might get some kind of program or financial assistance at a college or something. But for now, we're keeping pretty busy. Now today, we're gonna make a quick trip to Minnewaukan. We're waiting on the shred truck. Also, we filled Candy's shred tub and our tub, plus we got boxes of files to get rid of. We cleaned out one complete file cabinet. Roger's going to move downstairs for an auction, if there is one. And Bryce has, my biggest concern is making sure that the database program that we use to fill out forms, he's caught on real quick. He sat down and he's doing it himself already. So that this part is going along really well. And not only that, he's a computer genius. I swear to God. I'm easy to impress in that category, but he can really dance around on a computer. So.
Well, that sounds very good.
I can already tell you Nelson and Benson are probably going to hire him just to do computer work. That's all we have. Unless you got anything you want to?
Nope. Well, I think you got it.
Okay.
You're liking the job?
Yes, sir. Yep. It's good. Real similar to what I was doing back at Camp Grafton. The volume's a little bit higher, and it's more veteran-centric rather than families and service members and stuff. So, dragging a few of the clients from camp over here while that office out there is vacant and stuff too. So, just.
It's vacant though?
Yes, they're hiring out for the family assistance job. And I was doing all the stuff was comp and pen, and then I'd send it to Stacey and stuff too, and now they're just cutting straight here, so.
Well, we'll be looking forward to seeing you often around here, and if there's anything you need from us, please don't hesitate to let us know.
Okay.
That's a good idea.
Anything else for Stacey or Bryce? Thank you both.
Thank you.
If you want to stick around for the VSO joint powers agreement,
okay.
Coming right up. So let's move that to ahead so we can send Bryce and Stacey back to their offices. Any changes on the joint powers with the Nelson and Benson counties? I didn't see any that stuck out.
Do you want it?
You
chime in on?
Well, I'll chime in, but you bring it up.
I visited with Stacy about this as far as percentage wise.
Mm-hmm.
We don't just really feel that the numbers should, we feel they should be different, but.
That would just bring up another can of worms.
Yeah.
Well, how should they be different?
You already brought it up, right? Didn't you bring it up? What the numbers should be, I'm just kidding.
Yeah.
What numbers you talk about?
The percentage, how it breaks down, Ramsey's covered 60%, Benson is 22.
22.
Nelson 18.
Nelson's 18.
Alright.
When we originally did this, it was 50, 25, and 25.
Right.
I still feel that was the right way to go. Their opinions, well, Nelson's opinion, that it should be based on the amount of people we see and the amount of work done. They don't know the amount of work we do. And it's not just a person walking in the office. We have to be there when a veteran dies. We have to be there when the mail comes in. We have to be there to answer emails of all sorts, state, federal. It's just, there's more to it than just seeing somebody that walks in the door. Like on our annual report, if you want to get down to numbers, Nelson County, we saw 94 veterans in Nelson County. They're at 18%. Benson County, we saw 61 veterans. They're at 22%. Right there is kind of your answer, if you were going to look at people coming in the door. And that's not the whole picture, is people coming in the door. There's more to it.
Now, if I remember right, when we were negotiating this out, it wasn't based on the number of seen veterans in each county, it was based on the total number of veterans in each county, correct?
That was a lot of it, and they've all changed, and they've all changed with the numbers. So that part you have right. But just for example, Nelson will be losing more veterans than the rest of the counties. Ramsey's going to be gaining more veterans, and Ramsey's numbers are up. A lot of it has to do with Camp Grafton.
Well, I mean, I guess unless one of the other counties raises an issue with it, I'd say leave it as is.
Benson or Nelson have no problem with it?
Not, I'm not that person that they'd speak to. I think they'd speak to Candy more so.
I'd prefer to leave it alone. I would just say leave it alone.
Well, yeah, let's present it to them, and if they have issue, they'll raise it.
They're all right with it, so be it.
I'd make the motion that we sign the agreement again, as is.
Been moved in second. Any further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Veteran Service Joint Powers Agreement is approved.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next item of unfinished business is the home rule discussion. Since Chairman Lightbon is not here, Commissioner Wakefield, do you have anything you'd like to add on that before we?
Well, so just to refresh my own memory on this, we left it at we were going to advertise, correct? Okay.
Did we advertise? No response? We need, this memo here is five, is that what it says?
Yeah, it's still.
We need five members from the public. You find three, I'll find two.
Well, I think we have to prove it today, right? We don't have another meeting. We have time for, do we? Do we have two more meetings?
We have one more.
We have one more, I mean? Okay. I was wondering, are you guys here for that purpose?
Oh, no, we're here under the.
Can you be here for this purpose?
You guys haven't been here for this discussion. I think part of the reason that we haven't gotten very much interest in being on the committee because we wanted to reach out to the original committee members is because of what a time commitment it was last time. And my feeling that being was the case, I want to alleviate those concerns by saying it's not our intention as a board, and obviously when the Home Rule Charter Committee is established, they can go whatever direction they want to go. But it's not our intention on this board to see the charter significantly reworked. Essentially, we want to make some tweaks. We want to get some more public comment and feedback. But what we don't want to do is write a charter from the ground up again if we can avoid that. And so I think the time commitment this time around should be much, much less burdensome. You know, I know that that was a huge ask last time around. It was good work that we did, but.
Yeah, I totally agree. I think it was great work. On my part, I'm not going to speak on Susie's behalf, of course, but a great part for me was the amount of time, because we have some things coming down at the chamber that would be, that are time consuming for us with short an employee. We took on one employee to take on for two, so that's been a little different on the side of the chamber for us. And the other side of it for me was, I think some new blood would be beneficial for it, instead of getting back the same board, the committee that you had. So those were a little of the reasons that I stepped back from it. I can't, of course, speak for Susie's reasoning, but I think time was a little bit on your side as well.
Yes, time. I find myself in a couple of statewide subcommittees at the moment, which is actually taking up quite a bit of my time. And then, I'm talking with Paula, I think some new blood would be good for it as well.
Yeah, I mean, I don't disagree on that note.
I do feel though, if you're not rewriting the whole piece in itself, I'm not quite sure what you're doing with the rule. What was the, can you kind of come back to?
So it's,
we have to more or less go through this formality of setting this committee up.
Okay.
Whether we meet once, mm-hmm. which would probably be it.
Okay.
Right, otherwise, I mean, in order to put it on the ballot.
You need to have one meeting?
No, you need to establish a charter committee, and you need to have at least, I think it's one public hearing on it. But other than that, the Century Code is very vague in terms of what a charter committee needs to do during the time that it's formed. And so we did almost all of the legwork. I can't imagine there's much there that we couldn't get done in, say, two meetings. You know, one meeting to sort of recap and say, here's where we're at, a public hearing to get comment. I'm thinking that if I'm on this committee again, I'd like to probably myself, and any of the committee members that were interested, host a couple of, sort of like we did before, informational meetings, just getting out there. Obviously, if certain members of the committee can't be there for time reasons, that's understandable. And then have another meeting with the sort of collated comments that we got from the community, the sense of the thing. And then the charter committee makes a recommendation on whether or not to send the charter to the county commission with a recommendation for or against passage, just like we did last time. The problem is, are you going to have public hearings before the actual committee has ever met? Because otherwise you can't make any changes if you're going to need to.
I don't want any changes to make.
And both of you,
the way it is.
And both of you obviously stand behind the document that was presented last time. You know, it was a good document. It was well done. It was, and just for public's record, it wasn't given a whole lot of additional powers to the county commission. What it was doing was creating a different revenue source or potential for
the ability to ask.
The ability to ask the public to bring that forward for the committee or for a public-wide vote to establish different revenue sources for the county, because right now we're bound by one, and that's increasing property taxes, which nobody likes to see in their mailboxes. But if we were able to do a county-wide sales tax, for instance, or something to that nature that the public felt necessary through a vote, and that I think that Home Rule Charter established how it was going to be done, and specific timelines and specific purposes with a sunset clause on it, so it once it reached that, it would either go away or it'd have to come back in front of the people for a vote.
Yeah, I mean, just to add to that, there was no other example of a home rule charter in the state that had been adopted that had as strong of protections for the taxpayer as ours did. Sunset clauses, and any time it goes for a vote, it has to include, as you said, the purpose of the tax. But I think in that way, it's important because it'll allow us to leverage our position as a tourism, the tourism portion of our economy. Otherwise, while the lion's share of your community and business commercial revenue is from agriculture, the entirety of the tax base is from property tax. So therein lies kind of the rub. But that was the beauty of establishing a charter last time, and I think again this time, is we can sort of pass it in pure form, where we're not looking to raise revenue, or we're not looking to change something. It's mostly just, hey, would you allow us to have this toolbox? So.
I'd like to point out, though, you got your old board members, none of them were interested. You advertised in the community, nobody's interested. It just seems like the government, local government, is pushing this. And I just don't see this. I mean, if there was interest for this, somebody should be sitting here telling me this. Not you. That's just my opinion of that. I just cannot see, the amount of time that we've already spent looking for new board members. We've advertised and nobody's come forward, so it's really does not appear to be huge interest in it.
But
in my book.
But I think that's a failing of information, personally.
Then you should go searching for that information.
No,
if I was interested, I would be here asking questions. But if you put it out there and nobody's interested, then to me, us looking for board members is just us pushing it as a commission. I just don't think that's our job. We put it out there. There it is. Nobody was interested. That's just my opinion on that.
And I think that if government has a solution to be more efficient, we have a duty to try to inform people of the benefits.
We did that. We advertised. Nobody came. It's just like with these board commitments, we don't have 50 applicants for them because they're not interested. That's just my opinion. I have nothing against any of it, but that's just my opinion on how that shakes down.
I mean, I guess I sit on a lot of volunteer boards in this community, and every single one of them has the same problem, which is getting community engagement.
Absolutely.
And people in the community tend to love that things exist for them to do.
Absolutely.
And that these organizations and entities exist to serve them, but they don't like to put any time and effort into it.
Absolutely.
So I don't feel discouraged, nor do I feel that it's a condemnation of the idea of home rule that nobody's lining up to give their time. Because there are people that aren't lining up to work at the Hope Center, and they're not lining up to work at Heritage Center.
But people do come forward and do that. People that are interested do that.
Candy, can you answer the questions? Notice when it says published 6th and the 9th and 13th of March. So it really has, the advertisement hasn't went out yet.
It hasn't went to the paper. It's on the website. It's on Facebook.
But it hasn't been in the paper yet.
No. And that's all because of publishing dates and deadlines. You have to have it to the paper to be in a certain date. So.
Okay. I'm just asking,
yeah.
I guess. I'm not,
and
I haven't seen it in the papers.
And I do think that we have one more commission meeting ahead of us before this deadline is reached and passed. And so if we want to continue with that discussion, have that advertisement that we set forth at our last commission meeting, and maybe ask that Paula and Susie maybe can share that with one of their emails out to their members or something, and see if there'd be any representation through the chamber organization or something.
Well, and
like
let me just say that I'll go back and take a look at this again and give it some thought.
Yeah.
I won't certainly take it off the table. It sounds as though it's something that is a definitely, like you said, it was something that we gave a lot of thought to and put a lot of time and effort into, and I don't want to just see it fail. So with that, I'll give it more consideration this time and get back to you. Did Anthony ever get back?
I think he said
no. Okay, all right. Yeah, so let me do some thinking and I'll get back to you by the end of the week on this. So,
thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.
So we'll continue that on for a discussion at our March 17th meeting. Perfect. Any other discussion on normal old discussion?
Could we get some information out into the public about this? Because we really, you know, this is the first time I've heard this discussion.
Oh.
I thought it was already settled by the vote and the last time it was brought up, you know, but then again, I go to these meetings, and as a taxpayer who lives in Devil's Lake and pays property taxes, I don't want to be the only one to foot the bill if, say, we take over the law enforcement center.
Right.
And so on.
I mean,
what's that going to mean? You know.
And then that's going to be a real challenge if that comes to that. And I know, you know, especially in a community like this, it's a touchy subject to discuss taxation.
Yeah.
Anywhere.
But
it's a touchy subject.
Absolutely.
But that being said, if I think, you know, a responsible and responsive government
right.
tends to connect ends and means to the best of its abilities. And
absolutely.
So in cases where we need to maintain roads that go to boat landings, or they go to resorts, or they go to any of those things. Does it make sense that a farmer up in Edmore's property tax pays so that those boats and RVs can go by if we can get the boat owners and the RV owners, who generally speaking are not from this community, to foot some of the bill for the services and the infrastructure that they're enjoying?
Right.
You know, so in that way, giving the county the ability to ask, and I think that that's something that's really important to add here, we are not putting a sales tax or any kind of a tax in place. All that we're doing is asking for the ability to ask.
To do that.
You know, so that if in the future it becomes necessary to ask for additional tax or revenues, we can do so. Because right now, we legally can't. And that's one and one of the primary avenues that a home rule charter is a good idea. It gives some additional flexibility in our ability to utilize ordinances and things like that, but beyond that, it's not going to, in a significant and substantial way, change the way that the county does business. So if it were enacted, the courthouse would not be shuffled, there wouldn't be a big upheaval, business would continue as usual by the way that we've written it. Is just we'll be adding more tools to our toolkit, which is why I think it's a great idea.
And that's a good way of putting it. And I believe that people need to hear that and know that, you know.
And I think that that's part of the reason that it didn't pass. I mean, it came within 45 votes, and I really truly believe that every time that I had a conversation with someone, and it takes a little while to explain what it is,
sure.
That they left that, if not totally in support of it, then at least not totally opposed to it, which I think is a good thing. And I just think it was a failure of outreach. You know, it's hard to get enough bugs and enough ears. That's where you come in.
Maybe
it shouldn't just be me. I guess what I see is if there was a base for this, for like a groundswell of, I don't know, other taxpayers, you know, that were behind this movement, you know, I think that would go a long way. But I don't know why there isn't, or maybe there is, you know.
Well, I mean, I'd say that the way that the vote fell would argue that there is. But on top of that, you know, you've got more than a dozen examples of other counties in the state that have, you know, and on top of that, Louise, the counties that have passed that, you know, home rule charter tend to be the more urbanized, the ones that have more specialized needs, right? And I would argue that as, you know, the 11th biggest community in the state, we should rank among those 13, 14, you know, in our case. So.
I've always wanted to do this since I've been on the commission, Louise, that I understood home rule. This could be very beneficial to Ramsey County.
Right.
Very beneficial. I mean, the lodging and the meal tax that got put on, you know, to be able to do that, I mean, that helps. You know, helps them with their advertising. This could be very beneficial to Ramsey County. Other than the property taxes to take care of everything.
Yeah.
You know, with the passing of House Bill 2124, in the last legislative session and the previous session, the bill of 2206 for the social service funding, that was very beneficial for Ramsey County taxpayers. Very beneficial.
Oh, yeah.
$2 million.
Yep.
Approximately. That was very beneficial. And that's the way it should be funded through state. They didn't squeal too long to get it done, but they did do a little squealing. But it was very beneficial to Derby County in North Dakota.
Sure.
So, I could see this could be very beneficial to Ramsey County.
Right.
And Lucas says with the closeness of the vote, you know, there's quite a groundswell that I think it's all right. We just need a little more. And instead of throwing all the burden on the property taxes.
Yeah.
And maybe, Louise, if you're planning on doing any type of story on today's meeting or anything in the future, whether it be print or digital, you could include the link to that home rule charter that was brought to the vote last time. It was a very good document. It's still listed on our website.
Okay.
And Candy can get you that link to that. And that way people can take a look at it. Sure. And if they have a strong opinion one way or another, they can certainly let us know.
And then just mention that they need members.
Yeah. And we do need members for the committee.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Candy, could you answer this? And no internet publishing, is that pretty costly or more than the print than it goes in the paper? Considerably more?
We do it on our own. We put it on our own website.
Yeah.
We put it on our Facebook page.
You don't have an approximate cost, would you, on two issues? 2 days like that? Same day as the paper?
I don't know. We've never done.
You've never done it. Louise, would you know what putting the notice on the internet would cost at the paper approximately?
I don't have any idea. That's not my purview.
Okay, moving on. Any further discussion on home rule discussion?
That'd be all right.
We'll make a decision on that committee on the 17th. So, thank you. Any other unfinished business? Move on to new business. First item of discussion would be North Central Housing Authority board appointment.
Who's on here now?
Robin Friday.
I think Robin was
nobody from the
letting us know that she was not interested in the deal.
Yep. We didn't have that.
No, we usually get a recommendation from Paula. That's like of a board that, you know.
And has she recommended anyone? So how long can we afford to leave this vacant? We wait until she does.
I think this just expired like March 1st, so I can reach out to her again today and tell her that, you know, we need someone.
Yeah, if we usually wait for a recommendation, I'd be most comfortable if we did that again.
Have we advertised for anybody?
Nope.
So we need to do that as well. Let people know that. position open on the North Central Housing Authority.
Well, the issues we had at the last meeting over that department, that's the interest of the commission to advertise for that position, see if we can get somebody on there that has an interest in it, to watch over it. Because the things that were brought to our attention, that's not healthy for our community at all.
You know, is that a 2 or a 3 year appointment or?
I think they're usually 3.
Okay.
You're gonna be some other ones you ever got advertised for too, or what?
Yep, forward Devil's Lake, Wage One is no longer interested.
Weed Board, we're gonna be there.
Weed Board we have, we just need reappointment to those.
I make a motion to reappoint, get that out of the way.
I'll second.
On the Weed Appointment Board?
Yep.
Moved and seconded that we approve the two applicants that were interested in recommitting their services to the Weed Board. Further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign.
Do we need a motion on advertising for those other two? Also moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded that we advertise for the other two board appointments, North Central Housing Authority and Forward Devil's Lake Board Appointment.
Thank you.
Any further discussion on that? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion approved. Homestead Credit.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Moved and seconded that we approve the Homestead Credit. Any further discussion? If not, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same side. Approved site authorization, this is gaming for, I think, Lake Region State Foundation.
Moved to approve. Second.
Moved and seconded that we approve the site authorization. Any further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Visitors Committee Guidelines and Restaurant Lodging Tax Ordinance Appointment to Visitors Committee. So I think we had those in our packets for, and it's changing, adding 2 representatives from the county to the Visitors Guide Committee, or Guide Visitors Committee, Guidelines Visitors Committee. There we go.
This is what?
Going from a 7 to a 9 person board.
Right. Yeah, we have a current Visitors Committee Guidelines in place right now, so we were thinking about just adding in all the Ramsey County aspects of it to make just one document. So I've worked with Carrie on that.
Good idea.
Carrie, did you see any problems with anything?
I've actually emailed back and forth with some suggestions to make it more than just Devil's Lake to be the Ramsey County. That was really my suggestion on the guidelines.
Have those not been incorporated yet?
No, I think what was sent to a commission to look at had those, you know, parts on there, and they wanted to add commission or county here. So if that's all that the board wants, I think we can easily fix that, I think.
Oh, definitely. Yeah, this was just kind of a working draft at the moment.
So right now we have a motion to approve the guidelines or the... What was that official?
Visitors
Committee. As recommended, any further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. And then it was appointment to the Visitors Committee. We need 2 of those.
Now, are these members of the community or commissioners?
I think they can be either one, can they not?
I
I did have a conversation with Kyle Blanchfield, and he is interested at to be an appointee, if you guys so wish. So I was just going to let you know that.
Do you want us to advertise for this?
Yeah, I don't know if we necessarily have to do it right now. We're not going to approve the tax, or we won't start collecting the tax till April 1st. So if we want to advertise for it, I think that would be great. Yeah.
Hey, add that to the advertisement list.
Add that to the advertisement. Okay.
Yeah, he was the only one I'd had a chance to have a conversation with.
He's
kind
interested.
Of in passing, but yeah,
very
he's
good.
Interested.
Make sure you remember that.
So it's been moved and seconded that we advertise for appointments to the visitors committee. Any further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
My other question on that with Carrie was as far as the agreement goes with the Chamber of Commerce, how we're going to handle that.
And the agreement that you provided is what is in place with the city.
With the city.
Correct. So that is a 6-year agreement. Correct.
Yes.
And then subject to like a 30-day termination notice on part of either party?
Yes. And we have in the past gone and made revisions within that 6 years, but
sure.
Yeah, it's just a 6 year.
And it looks like an annual type of a discussion about it. Is that correct? Like an annual discussion?
Possibly. I don't think we've ever had an annual discussion.
The ability to have the
yes,
annual
exactly.
discussion, I guess. And then 90,000 or 30% of tax collection, whichever is greater, is what's being currently paid by the city, correct?
Correct.
For administrative costs?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I was thinking that, you know, since it's the first year we'll be collecting, they'll have no idea
right.
where we'll be. But I would like to keep that 30% in to help with all of our administrative costs that go towards our building, our salaries, you know, that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
So this is the second part of the agreement with the chamber and city county kind of now?
Yeah. This would be the agreement with the Ramsey County with the Devil's Lake Area Chamber of Commerce to basically have the ability to accept the tax that would go into the visitors committee that we've established in the other document. Yeah.
Okay. So do we just remove the City of Devil's Lake portion on this agreement, replace it with Ramsey County?
Yeah, I got it marked up.
Okay.
You got it all right, Carrie.
I got it marked up.
Good.
We'll have Carrie go through this and work with you guys, bring it back to our March 17th meeting if possible. That way it can be in place prior to the April 1st collection.
Mm-hmm.
Perfect. Anything else on the visitor guide, restaurant, and lodging tax ordinance? Everything looks good? Good. Any other new business?
I was just going to say I'll work with Carrie on making all the final changes on this.
Sounds good.
And then if we could look at it at the 17th meeting, and then I'll also bring it to the City Commission for approval on the 16th as well.
So one quick question. Do you want an agreement? Are you going to have two separate agreements, one with the city and one with the county, or are you trying to do a global, or what is it here?
No, I think the agreements would have to be
separate. Yep,
yep.
I agree.
Yep.
Okay. I just wanted to make sure we were on the same page.
But I'll have them look at the changes to the visitor committee guidelines.
Okay.
Since they're part of that one.
Any other new business? Visitors, delegations, Paula, Susie, anything other than what we've already discussed? Louise? Okay. Portfolios. Want to start, Commissioner Olson?
LEC, we had a meeting, I
here a couple weeks ago. Some ideas were brought forward. I haven't heard back on any of those yet. I know the incarcerations are up. We're up to like 90 here the other day, which is good. Other than that, it's business as usual. Pretty quiet.
There was a good meeting on the 19th. Where we got to go through and tour the facility and see the changes and the enhancements at the that the security cameras and all those kind of changes made. So, good meeting, good discussion. Thank you. Anything else?
That's all I got.
Okay. Mr. Brown?
Just on the law enforcement center, on the 15th of April, our next regular meeting for the board out there, DOC is going to do their inspection on the 13th and 14th, and they'll be at our next regular meeting at 8 o'clock in the morning on the 15th to give their results and answer any questions any board members have or commissioners, which they're all going to be invited again to come to that meeting if they so desire. To ask any questions and to listen to Werlinger and Anderson, Mr. Anderson, and whoever else they'll have with them. Rob told me that yesterday, Mark. So I talked to him and he's working on the joint powers. They're setting up a meeting for this Friday for the joint powers to try to get something put together there with more teeth in it. If you remember, we brought up Dickinson, Stark County, and Rob called the director out there and she said, well, ours was written in 1982. So, I said we followed our watch, the city had been written a couple of years ago. So. And Jamestown, Hudson County has one. So we're looking at that. Still trying to find an attorney. If you have any thoughts, Carrie, you could share them in the near future, I suppose, on who to get for
creating the joint powers.
Yeah. And then law enforcement, or social service, we had our last meeting with the zone board. It went real well. And we have a new director. Our old director is a new director. So, Rhonda Allery got the job. And. Just as good as she with the zone as she did with our local county social organization. Other than that, I think that's all I got. Any questions? But everybody's invited to that April 15th meeting at 8 o'clock. And Werlinger will be there, Anderson will be there, the ones that are doing the inspection. And if there's any questions, boy, that would be the time to ask.
You meant March, though, not April.
April. April's our meeting. Yeah, it's not our next one in March.
Okay.
They're going to be here in April.
Okay.
And they're going to be here Monday and Tuesday of that week. And then we have a regular meeting Wednesday morning. And they're staying to inform the board. So it is 15th of April, I believe. It's the third Wednesday. I think you said that.
That'd be right.
So, law enforcement's getting ready for that. So, I expect it to go very well. That's all I have.
Good. Thank you. Commissioner Wakefield.
I have absolutely nothing to report. Kidding me. Must have said my piece already today.
Heritage Center, I think your gala is coming up in May.
Yeah, that's right. I should check that, my emails.
I thought I saw an advertisement for that big extravaganza.
I'll get back to the next meeting on when that is exactly. I don't wanna misspeak.
Let's see, from my standpoint, extension is going good. They're done fine with their transition from and Bill and Sarah switching spots as office department head, and things are going good. Carrie's been busy extremely with all her activities. She did say that, what was it, an indigent?
Oh, yeah, the state's opening an indigent defense office here somewhere in Devil's Lake.
Somewhere in Devil's Lake. So, said yesterday they're doing interviews for office staff for that up there. And, so, obviously, some of our numbers in the courts have been.
They've been higher.
Been high. So, thank you.
Just as a comparison, I think Ramsey County was less than 100 of the same cases that Stetson County had last year. And I think they have six or seven in their office. So, I mean, Walsh is the same size office as Ramsey County's, and I think they have less than half of the cases that we have. So it's just interesting, but I think across the state, everybody is saying that cases are just up. They're just up.
Wow, wow, wow. Yep.
Has there been any progress that we've heard on that opioid lawsuit?
No. I think because I saw something about the bankruptcy wave that some of the pharmaceutical companies were kind of falling into, so I don't know how that will impact for us at the end of the day. I'm sure it will.
I think you need to use the old checks in the mail theory.
Don't spend it before you get it, right?
Yes, correct. 25% of nothing is nothing.
I know Kevin is gone, Chris is gone, the emergency manager. Both of them are certainly staying informed and up to date on any potential spring flooding outlooks. Right now the Weather Service has us pegged at about a 90% chance of reaching about 1451, 50.7, I think is what they're looking at for a 90% chance, going up another 2 feet from where we're at. I think Kevin is well ahead of that game with his roads, and Chris's as far as been going to a lot of different trainings on spring flooding. I don't think we have it as bad as a lot of places within the state. That James River Basin and the Red River Basin are certainly going to be at the forefront of discussions, but we'll get our fair share of moisture. Ours comes at a little slower pace and sticks around for a much longer time too, so is what it is. And other than that, anything else for the good of the business?